A very good evening to one and all. We have gathered today for an academic feast on the challenges in managing hypertension with a special focus on moxonidine. We have with us today as our esteemed speaker, Dr. Vishal Gole, Senior Consultant Nephrologist and Renal Transplant Physician at Anand Loke Multispeciality Hospital, Siliguri. As a nephrologist, Dr. Gole would have a vast experience in seeing a lot of CKD cases who manifest with a resistant hypertension. Without wasting much time, I hand over the session to Dr. Gole. Over to you, sir.
So, good evening. First of all, I'm sorry that I was not able to do this program on last week because of family problems. So, it was postponed to Thursday, middle of the week. So, I hope there will be participants to listen to the talk. So since we are dealing with the topic of resistant hypertension, so we assume that we know basics about hypertension and the definitions of hypertension, and then we are going one step ahead of that and dealing with the resistant case of hypertension. So first of all, when we define resistant hypertension, so it means that it's a blood, when the blood pressure remains above the target, even after giving three antihypertensive drugs of different classes, which we assume that should be one calcium channel blocker, one of the angiotensin receptor blocker or AC inhibitors, and one of them should be a diuretic, and most of the drugs should be prescribed in optimum doses. So this is how we define a resistant hypertension. Suboptimal doses of blood pressure, which does not include a diuretic, normally doesn't fall in the category of resistant hypertension. There are various reasons for that. Also, we can define resistant hypertension as a hypertension which needs four or more drugs for hypertension control, which is again directly what this definition means. To divide this again in simply into what is uncontrolled hypertension and what is resistant hypertension, to define it as resistant hypertension, again, we need at least three drugs to control the blood pressure. If we manage to control the blood pressure with four medicines, then it is a resistant hypertension which is controlled. So it is a controlled resistant hypertension. And if we are needing five or more than five drugs, so this is a subcategory of resistant hypertension, which is known as a refractory hypertension. That is, it is not controlled with the basic drugs. So the topic for today is moxonidine, which is not one of the first line medicines, and it usually comes into play once we land up with this type of patient, that is either a resistant type of hypertension or a refractory hypertension. And how do we choose these medicines and where moxonidine stands? So that is the basic talk for today, and I'll try to make it as succinct as possible so that we can take home a few important messages. So always resistant hypertension, when it is seen, it is usually associated with a few comorbidities, and the most common ones being a patient who is obese, has a chronic kidney disease, has underlying metabolic disorders like diabetes, or has cardiovascular disorders, cardiac problems, strokes, atrial fibrillation. So these are the associated comorbidities with resistant hypertension. And why does hypertension become resistant? So this is basically not class, it's wrongly typed. It's causes of resistant hypertension. So first of all, whenever we are dealing with resistant hypertension, we should be clear that we are not dealing with pseudo-resistant hypertension, which is hypertension that is apparently resistant, but it is not so. So the common causes includes improper measurement of office blood pressure, white coat hypertension, wrong physician assessment of hypertension, and physician bias for not reaching the targets and not understanding the targets. So these are various reasons why these patients are mislabeled as resistant hypertension, and they are known as pseudo-resistant hypertension. The other important causes of resistant hypertension includes identifiable disorders, which comes in the category of secondary hypertension. Various substances which the patient is taking, like they are not careful about the salt intake, they are taking too much of salt, overeating and taking too much alcohol, some biologic factors like sleep apnea, the metabolic syndrome, and the various categories of metabolic syndrome parameters, and obesity, and improper or inadequate treatment by the patient, poor compliance to therapy, and a failure of the patient to adhere to the medical regimen. Main reason for this is many of the times either because of the cost or because the patient has some side effects which was not explained by the physician treating the patient, and they tend to drop out the medicines which causes the problem. So first of all, before defining resistant hypertension, we should know that these are not the reasons why the hypertension has become resistant. We again know that 80 to 85% of all hypertension across all ages, especially the elderly, are primary hypertensives. Secondary hypertension is seen in less number of cases, and the common causes of secondary hypertension includes renoparenchymal. So renal causes, kidney disorders, and chronic kidney disease remains the one of the most common causes of secondary hypertension, and many of these cases tend to be resistant. So is primary hyperaldosteronism, the other disorders like Cushing's, the hormonal disorders, pheochromocytoma, patients taking drugs which interferes with the metabolism of various antihypertensives, narcotics, and hormonal therapies, etc. So these are all the secondary causes of hypertension that has to be assessed before labeling them as resistant hypertension, and we should cure them because otherwise the BPE remains uncontrolled. In any case of resistant hypertension, one third, at least more than one third of the cases usually end up being pseudo resistant. So the common causes, as I've already told, is improper measurement of blood pressure. Patient are not the correct measurement of blood pressure techniques, the 5 minutes rest and avoidance of caffeine and all those important, instructions are not followed, and the cuff size doesn't match the patient's arm size. The patient has a white coat effect. They have hypertension in the office, but it remains normal at home. Old patients with severely calcified arteries where there is a falsely high blood pressure recording. Again, clinician inertia is common because of irrational prescription of drugs and not following the basic guidelines, or if they are not having much idea about what is the target to be achieved. So these are the common causes of pseudo hyperresistance, and we can overcome this pseudo resistance by ambulatory blood pressure monitoring. Especially the white coat effect can be ruled out by a proper ambulatory blood pressure monitoring or a home blood pressure monitoring, and we can rule out at least this basic reason for pseudo hyperresistance. It's quite common, approximately around the prevalence of white coat hypertension is around 20-25% in office practice. So it is quite a big amount. So we should understand that instead of before hiking the drugs, we have to rule out this effect by at least an ambulatory blood pressure monitoring, or if not, if it is expensive, then at least periodic home blood pressure monitorings and follow up with the records is a good idea. So to work up resistant hypertensive cases, again, as we have already told, taking a proper history is important. The drug regimen should include a diuretic before defining it as resistant hypertension, as the definition is clearly implies. And again, ambulatory blood pressure monitoring is the most important test to be done to rule out at least the commonest cause of hypertension in the office, that is a white coat effect. Other barriers, again, taking proper history is important. We can rule out the various causes that I've already mentioned by taking a proper history and examination. And if there is a suspicion for secondary hypertension, if the patient has a raised creatinine or urine albumin, then we can rule out many of the secondary causes and we can treat them before we increase the number of drugs. So most of the blood pressure medicines bring down blood pressure by a factor of around 5 to 10 millimeters of mercury. So the number of drugs that is given to patients can be roughly estimated by the level of blood pressure elevation above the upper limit of normal. So if the blood pressure is very high, we can usually start with a combination therapy. As per the guidelines, the majority of guidelines, they tell to start one of these three drugs as the first line therapy and combine them till we reach the triple combination. Once a patient becomes resistant, even after the optimization of these three group of drugs, we find out that the most common cause of secondary or the resistant hypertension is primary aldosteronism, and approximately 15 to 20% of resistant hypertension do have hyperaldosteronism, or they have various levels of aldosterone elevation, and therefore adding on another drug, the first one should be aldosterone receptor antagonist, which you mineralocorticoid antagonist, and spironolactone is the one which is commonly used until and unless there are specific side effects like patient is having CKD or they have hyperkalemia or otherwise. If not, then we can go on for the other drug combination. The other drugs which are chosen in series after this includes the alpha blockers, the central agonists that we are talking about, various other drugs like minoxidil and all. So before prescribing this drug, we should understand the various side effects and the advantages that this drug will give. For example, an old patient with prostate hypertrophy may benefit more by adding a prazosin instead of other drugs. If a patient has severe diabetic autonomic neuropathy, then adding prazosin again may cause problems because these patients have autonomic dysfunction and postural hypertension. And so adding prazosin might put a patient at more risk of falls. Similarly, adding on one of the central agonists, one of them which we are discussing, the clonidine is notorious to cause dry mouth and drowsiness. So a very old patient living alone might not benefit with clonidine. So these are some of the ways in which we can combine this medicine in a more proper way. So we have to understand various side effects before adding on drugs, and we should know why we are adding these medicines. So one of the important mechanisms of blood pressure is the sympathetic overactivity, and the other one is obviously the salt pathway, the salt and water hypothesis of hypertension, and another is sympathetic overactivity. Normally in people who have one of the metabolic syndrome factors, like they are obese or they have high triglyceride or they have visceral obesity and dyslipidemia and all, so these people usually have sympathetic overactivity as the one of the driving forces for hypertension. So focusing only on the salt part of the hypertension might not control the blood pressure in this group of patients. So this is the place where control of sympathetic overactivity comes, and where the drug for discussion of today comes. So again, as we know, that sympathetic overactivity has been found as an important factor in elevated blood pressures, even in animal models as well. And people having the plasma epinephrine level is higher in hypertensive patients than in non-hypertensive controls. And sympathetic activation is also seen in early phases of hypertension. And in some of the patients, those who already have a higher sympathetic activity, the presence of sympathetic hypertrophy can be seen even before the blood pressure is elevated in observational studies. Again, as I told, obesity, there's a strong link with sympathetic activation. It also contributes to insulin resistance. So this is the additional problem that sympathetic overactivity causes. And it is also implicated in left ventricle hypertrophy and also as a factor in congestive heart failure. So comes the rationale for moxonidine. So moxonidine is, it basically, the sympathetic tone is controlled by the central pathways from the brainstem, especially the rostral ventrolateral medulla. This region contains the imidazoline I1 receptors and the alpha-2 adrenal receptors. So these drugs, this group of drugs, to which clonidine as well as moxonidine belongs, they cross the blood-brain barrier and goes and acts on these receptors, the alpha-2 adrenal receptors and imidazoline I1 receptors in various degrees. Some of them binds alpha-2 receptors more, some of them binds imidazoline receptors more. So the various effects and the side effects are a resultant of the differential binding to these receptors. And this reduces the sympathetic activity, the peripheral sympathetic activity that comes out of the midbrain and the brainstem. And therefore, the peripheral sympathetic activity tends to come down, which causes peripheral vasodilatation and peripheral vascular relaxation. And it causes a decline in blood pressure. But since it also blocks the central sympathetic activity, the reflex bradycardia that is seen in many of the other vasodilators like amlodipine, CCBs, and as well as even with prazosin is not very commonly seen with, especially with moxonidine. Now, clonidine binds the alpha-2 adrenal receptors at a much higher degree than moxonidine. Moxonidine, which has a more preponderance of binding towards imidazoline I1 receptors. So this is the difference between clonidine and moxonidine. Binding of alpha-2 adrenal receptors causes the various side effects that is usually seen with clonidine, the dry mouth, the drowsiness, excess sleepiness, etc. These are all the resultant of greater affinity for alpha-2 adrenal receptors as compared to moxonidine, which does not have many of these side effects. Also, binding of alpha 2 adrenergic receptors in the periphery tends to overcome the peripheral sympathetic activity reduction centrally, which is seen with clonidine. If we give it in very high doses, in a reverse direction, it causes increase in the sympathetic activity by binding to the peripheral alpha adrenergic receptors. That's why when we give clonidine, we do not cross a threshold of drug level, because at a much higher level, it tends to cause a rise in BP because of the action on the peripheral receptors as well. This problem is not seen in moxonidine because it does not bind to alpha adrenal receptors that much. The efficacy of binding is 20:1 towards the imidazoline I1 receptors, which is around 4:1 for clonidine. Clonidine has a much shorter duration of action. It usually brings about a lowering of blood pressure in around 6 to 8 for around 6 to 8 hours, and that's why given in a dose of around 2 to 3 times a day. Whereas moxonidine has a much longer duration of action, and it is given either as a once a day or a twice a day dose, and the maximum dose is around 0.6 milligram. Clonidine, again, we can go up to 1.2 milligram, 2 milligram a day. So we usually start with a lower dose, around 0.2 milligram, and it's gradually titrated up to 0.4 milligram, either once a day or twice a day, and it can be increased further to 0.6 milligram after further 2 to 3 weeks. So we should gradually increase the dose, not give the maximum dose on first day itself, because it might cause some side effects. And the usual maintenance dose normally is around 0.4 milligrams, especially in kidney patients. In a lower GFR patient, we do not give a much higher dose of moxonidine, and we restrict to around 0.2 to 0.4 milligrams. So again, this is already covered. So it is effective when used as monotherapy. It is a good drug. It causes a lowering of blood pressure. There are a few data I will tell in the subsequent slides. It is also effective as an add-on therapy to the other first-line agents. It has a linear dose response from lower to higher dose, and thus allows titration, which is good. And it also has effects on insulin resistance. It improves glucose metabolism. It is lipid neutral. And it has, in some studies, it has some renal protective effect, maybe because of the various pleiotropic benefits that it has. So reviewing some of the literature, so as we go on, first, there was a trial published in Journal of Hypertension in monoxidine in patients with ESRD, where they had measured the sympathetic nerve activity in patients whose blood pressure and heart rate and all those things were similarly controlled. So the basic target was to see whether moxonidine reduces the sympathetic nerve activity, the muscle sympathetic nerve activity. So they measured the sympathetic nerve activity through various measuring devices, and they found out that low dose moxonidine produced a sustained and substantial reduction in sympathetic outflow without hemodynamically compromising these patients when they were added on to other therapy. So since we have already seen that sympathetic activity is one of the driving causes of hypertension, so this study had proven that it does cause an isolated action on the sympathetic nerve activity, which was unmistakable. And when it was also given as a monotherapy in a small trial, the blood pressure reduction was significant. So a significant reduction of around 20 millimeter mercury of systolic and 10 millimeter of diastolic blood pressure was seen when moxonidine was compared with placebo, which was as good as the first line agents like amlodipine. And it was also used in some trials as a combination therapy. In addition to people who were already given 2 or 3 antihypertensives, that is in patients who had either an uncontrolled type of hypertension or a resistant hypertension, and the reduction in both the day and night blood pressure was significantly seen, and it did benefit these patients by reducing blood pressure of up to 15.4 millimeter of mercury, and even when 24-hour blood pressure monitoring was done, significantly around 10 to 15 millimeter mercury of blood pressure was lowered. So again, another study combined moxonidine either as a monotherapy in one arm and in combination with amlodipine in another arm. In both the arms, moxonidine lowered blood pressure significantly. So it was well tolerated and effective either when used alone or in combination with the first line agent, which was amlodipine in this group. So there was a post-marketing surveillance study in Germany where they had given moxonidine in patients who had metabolic syndrome over 8 weeks. And this was quite a significant number of patients, around 4,000 plus patients. Moxarundine brought about a marked reduction in blood pressure of approximately around 20 to 25 of systolic and 13 of diastolic. And this increased with the severity of the underlying metabolic problems. So significantly in people who had metabolic syndrome, moxarundine brought down the blood pressure significantly, maybe because it was acting mainly on the reason why these people were hypertensive, which was sympathetic overactivity. Again, this also tells the same thing. So moxarundine was also compared head-to-head with another drug of the same group, which was clonidine. So problem with clonidine is that when we stop clonidine, there is a rebound hypertension. So the rebound hypertension effect is usually seen by the end of the day or by the next day, and these patients usually, the blood pressure shoots up. Whereas since moxarundine had a much longer half-life and the duration of action was higher, so it was presumed that moxarundine will not cause those effects. So this study proved that hypothesis, because both moxarundine as well as clonidine brought down the blood pressure to similar levels, and when it was stopped, the increase of blood pressure after stopping moxarundine was more gradual compared to clonidine. A sudden gradual, a sudden rise in blood pressure can trigger various cardiovascular events. So that is why clonidine is dangerous if it is stopped immediately. And there was one study in which moxarundine was combined with diet or diet alone for various parameters of endothelial dysfunction, which is again postulated to be responsible for the cardiovascular disorders of all types, of whether stroke or renal outcomes or otherwise. And there was a significant change when moxarundine was added across all the parameters that were studied, especially the systolic blood pressure, glucose, insulin levels, triglyceride levels, and the other the lipid levels. So again, this study proved that it has a benefit on correction of various endothelial dysfunction markers, and it should theoretically halt the progression of cardiovascular disorders and as well as diabetes, because it improves peripheral insulin resistance. This is also the same thing. So moxarundine is effective, and the tolerability has been studied across various studies. The data is quite robust. It has a clinical experience of over 7 years. There are a lot of trials over the last 15 years, 30 trials were published. Many of them were against placebo, which again did not show any serious drug adverse effects with moxarundine when given alone. It was again superior to clonidine, at least in the withdrawal trials, where the withdrawal rates was much lower with moxarundine compared to clonidine, again because the rebound hypertension and side effect profile was better. And again, you know, in the post-marketing surveillance studies, where the study population was around 19,000 odd, the side effects are quite low, and these side effects usually it's carried forward from the clonidine group. Some of these patients have dry mouth, and some of the patients do have some drowsiness, but the percentage of patients having these side effects is much less than compared to clonidine. So to summarize about the advantages of moxarundine, it is a good antihypertensive drug, which is comparable to the other first-line agents as well. It improves metabolic profile of patients, especially those who have metabolic syndrome, and especially in those in whom the sympathetic overactivity is seen. The effect lasts longer for 24 hours, and therefore it can be administered as an OD dose as well. It is safe and well tolerated with much less side effects compared to its other partner peers in the same group, as well as even the overall side effect profile is also not bad. And it is safe, and it has been shown to be effective when combined with the other first-line agents. Thank you. Yeah, I think we can discuss if there are people around.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kole. Very, very wonderful presentation, very clinically relevant. So can you unshare the screen so that we can discuss with the audience too?
Okay.
So very wonderful presentation, very clinically relevant, short, sweet, simple, to the point, wherein you discuss perspectives to resistant hypertension and the subset of even refractory hypertension. We're just waiting for questions from the audience. But sir, interim, as we get questions from the audience, one particular point wherein you discussed as resistant hypertension and the subset of five drugs and more being refractory hypertension. One question to you, sir, as a nephrologist, you would possibly get a lot of challenging patients as a result of them being in CKD, especially beyond stage three, wherein they come to you with resistant hypertension. And what are the challenges you face with, be it with calcific vessels or also a sympathetic overdrive, also the fact that you have to ensure that you're also giving erythropoietin on the side, taking care of the hyperphosphatemia, dyselectrolyteemias. So overall, what are the challenges that you face as a nephrologist when you see a hypertensive patient in CKD?
Yeah, when we see a hypertensive patient in our nephrology practice, many of these patients are very bad hypertensive because they already have been taking hypertensive drugs for a long time. On top of that, they start having chronic kidney disease. It adds on to the hypertensive problem. The number of drugs starts increasing, and they are taking a list of drugs of different types, cardiovascular drugs, erythropoietin. Many of them start having some infections. They start taking antibiotics on the side. Especially tuberculosis is quite common in CKD population. Many times we tend to miss the duct titration that happens when we start giving antitubercular drugs. The metabolism of the hypertensive drugs are also increased once we give them rifampicin. And this is one of the rare things that we see in more so in nephrology practice, because we have a big chunk of people who eventually become tubercular over a period of many years on dialysis because of immunosuppression. And if we are not attuned to taking a proper medical history of this patient, we might miss why these patients are resistant. So there is a few small things that happens in practice. And on an average, a CKD patient will require 2 to 3 hypertensives for blood pressure control. So that is quite understood. And once the GFR goes down, we are not able to give them the benefit of diuretics. So that is, again, another problem. They are all... many of them do have salt sensitive type of hypertension as one of the reasons. So a diuretic should have helped. But since the GFR goes down, the diuretic effect goes away, and we are not able to control the blood pressure again that well. We are not able to give them spironolactone, obviously.
Sure.
So we have to lean on the other drugs like moxonidine, prazosine, and in some cases we can go up to minoxidil and methyl-dopa and all those things later on. So these are the few problems. Now, if an astute physician does not understand the side effects of many of these drugs, like as I told in the talk of the problems of prazosin in old CKD patients, they can have falls because of postural hypertension. And so we should be careful in giving these drugs as a combination. So when we add on drugs as a second line, third line, fourth line, you should be able to explain to the patients about the side effects of this drug. We give them clonidine, if we don't tell them that it causes dry mouth, they will stop it without telling us. And then again, as I told, on the second day, they will go into a rebound hypertension and land up with a severe massive stroke in the emergency. So these are the few things that we have to take care of when we are dealing, especially in people with CKD.
So points very well said. So wherein maybe in a non-CKD patient where you would consider a mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, you would consider spironolactone, you can't consider that. A CKD patient.
Yes.
Again, a point very well said about diuretics, including loop diuretics, which would not work as the GFR reduces. And the perspective wherein you would have to bank on either alpha blockers or central sympatholytics for the same. So we also truly appreciate the perspective wherein you delineated your patients very clinically, saying, fine, maybe a hypertensive with a benign hypertrophy prostate, alpha blockers, prazosin would work. Of course, would benefit, of course, with the caveat that he doesn't develop postural hypertension or is not at risk for it. Again, a well-set point. The third and final take from our perspective, you also mentioned about mineralocorticoid excess states, of course, non-CKD patients. What caveats would you give to our doctors here attending on what they should screen in these patients? Should they check a serum potassium? Should they go for a bicarbonate? Some of these patients do not develop edema as a result of the aldosterone escape mechanism. But clinically, sir, what vignettes would you want to give to the doctors attending this session on mineralocorticoid excess states?
Okay, so I did not talk on that because, again, as I presume that we are coming into this talk knowing a lot of things about hypertension. So we always, as if you go back to the various guidelines, especially the JNC guidelines, it clearly mentioned that once you are diagnosing a hypertensive patient for the first time, there are a few tests that you have to do as a baseline test to find out whether they have, we can categorize these patients for choosing. And obviously, a renal function test, calcium, potassium, urine protein. We assume that these things should be checked in all hypertensive patients. So again, as I told, that a very high percentage of patients who have resistant hypertension have mineralocorticoid excess state. Either they have a primary hyperaldosteronism as such because of adenoadenomas, or they have a hyperaldosterone state as such. So if the kidney function is not compromised, then we can go ahead and measure a plasma renin activity or aldosterone to renin ratio we can measure. But again, in nephrology practice, we do not do it because it is anyway, the whole thing is botched up. So we will not be able to test that. But in general practice, if you are confused regarding what is happening to the patient, you can always go ahead and do a plasma renin activity as such, or a aldosterone to renin activity, or only aldosterone, fasting aldosterone level. So if the aldosterone level is high or if the PRA is high, then we can screen them for primary hyperaldosteronism. If it is not, we can straight away go in and add a mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist. You can give spironolactone. You can see wonderful results if they have a high aldosteronism. Adding a small dose of epinephrine will bring down the blood pressure much more than an amlodipine of 20 milligrams. So that is one thing that we can do in practice. And looking at the potassium helps because, again, a hypokalemic state is one where we can suspect people having hyperaldosteronism state, or in even in patient with renal artery stenosis, if you are suspecting a hypokalemia, can give a subtle signs that this patient might have underlying secondary hypertension conditions. So you can always screen these patients. And as far as the renal artery stenosis thing goes, if you ask our cardiology colleagues, they will always go ahead for stenting and all those things. But it has been published even in the AHA guidelines itself that the recommendation for doing stenting is very poor. It's 2C and low. So instead of going in for expensive tests like a renal Doppler or a CT angiography or a magnetic resonance angiography, you can go ahead and increase the number of drugs. It is more cost effective for this patient rather than investigating them thoroughly for renal artery stenosis, because even after diagnosing and even if you send them for a stenosis correction by putting stents, the correction might not help the patient that much. There is no recommendation to show that it helps. So these are a few of the things that physicians can note.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dr. Kole, for the wonderful pearls of wisdom. And I'm sure the audience that has attended the session has usually benefited from all the clinical vignettes that have turned out, including perspectives to resistant and refractory hypertension.
Okay.
Thank you very much, sir.
Looks like the three of us are the only participants, right?
I'm sure there would be people from the audience also. Akash, anybody else from the audience? Akash?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. How many logins do we have from the audience?
There are many, sir.
There are, sir. Okay. Audience, we request you to put your questions in the chat box.
So, I was hoping that you will have some questions, because that's why I cut short my talk.
Absolutely.
We can discuss. It's a much better way of... Okay. So if you don't have questions, then we can
sure.
Call it a day.
Sure, sir.
Okay.
Thank you very much, sir, for all the clinical vignettes once again. And on behalf of Macleod Pharmaceuticals, I, Dr. Parth Sarthy, would warmly extend my vote of thanks to you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Amending.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.